Hallelujah, Jesus. We love you, Lord. Give you glory, Lord. Give you praise, Father. Give you honor, Lord. Will somebody help me say, Lord, we love you. Give you honor, Lord. Give you praise. Give you praise, Lord Jesus. We say thank you. We say we love you, Lord. Praise you, Father. Worship you and adore you. There is glory, Lord, with you, and there's honor. We praise your name. Thank you, Father. And Lord, as we prepare to go into your word, pray, Lord, that you would give us a word not only for us, but for those that even that's not here, Lord. We pray that this word, Lord, will go forth unhindered. We pray that this word will go forth, Father God, with you only receiving the glory and the praise. And we'd be so careful as to say thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Put the hands together and give God some praise. You know, when songs like that play and they begin to minister to the pastor's heart, that's Gary's side of me coming out there. Amen. He's a good what? He's a good father. He's a good father. And on this Father's Day, it's serious that we really realize that the enemy may not look like it, but he's running to and fro. He's after our precious cargo, precious children. He's after whatever he can get. Whomever he can get. But I'm grateful for each of you, those of you that are here on this Father's Day, as we honor the fathers all around, those that are here, those that are watching by way of YouTube and other measures. Grateful for my wife. Thank you, Sugar. You work just as hard on Father's Day as you did for Mother's Day. And that's just you, so we love and appreciate you. There's nothing partial. Amen. And I'm grateful for the associates, their spouses, and so forth. God is good. Amen. I'm a blessed man to have some help. And I'm so appreciative of that, and we thank God for them. Amen. Amen. And to Brother Marty and Brother Rick, who is working together, taking instructions from the grandkids. God is good. Amen. Brother Marty and Sister Wells. Brother Marty's been here. We are at another Father's Day. God is good, isn't he? God is good. And you know, Brother Marty, I pray that God just helped to use you as a role model and as an example. I remember at the picnic, we was trying to come down a little hill, and they offered to give him a ride, and the guy said, no way, no way. I don't want to ride. He's grateful. Amen. It isn't amazing sometimes. Stuff that when you go through life, you just take for granted. Just take for granted. Don't realize it's the goodness of God that you're able to come and sit and be here and fellowship. And that's wonderful. Amen. So we just have to be very grateful. And I could go around the sanctuary and just know that the goodness of God has been here and is here. Amen. Now, I had a Father's Day message, which I'm going to share, and I'm going to just take my time and teach a little bit today. So I promise you I'm going to have you out before four for sure. But I want you to know how much I love you guys and appreciate you. And thank my daughter-in-law on the camera, my big friend, I say, and my son back there, both in the sound booth, making this stuff happen, come together. Give them both hands, amen, and my daughter-in-law. It's just God worked that thing out. Boy, God worked it, that my son would have a job in printing. So I can get all these nice looking programs and banners made and stuff. I said, God, you're just awesome. Most churches have to pay a different price. Amen. I get mine at or below. Amen. So the program you're holding in your hand there, he does all that and all this comes together. I said, God, you're good. And that's why you see, you can't let someone else determine success for you. You can't let someone else determine whether or not you're having a successful life or you're living a fruitful life. You can't do that. Amen. For some of us, success is based upon the fact that we thank God we're still here. Amen. Amen. But nothing but the goodness of what? God. Amen. And once we deal with the people issue and take care of that, we'll be all right. But no one can look at you and determine what is success for you. You are successful, and you walk in success when you walk in the will of God for your life. That's when you're successful. Amen. I'm going to talk to you a little bit. And if you stay with Pastor, amen, I promise you I'm going to behave and find out, amen, what Sister Reed has planned for this Father's Day. Amen. Open up to Genesis chapter 3, verse 8, if you will, please. Ma'am, please, sir. And they'll bring that up for me. And if you help me, I just want to preach from this thought or teach from this thought to the dads and say this. Say, Dad, find your place and stay there. Listen to the dads. Find your place and stay there. Genesis 3 and 8 says, God had made a special place where he could come and fellowship with his special creation. You and I are the greatest creation that God made. We are the highlight of his creation. I love it. Sometimes I'm in the backyard and I sit back there underneath the oak tree, and sometimes different bugs will fly by or whatever. You know, one bug flies up to me like a helicopter. He just stops perfectly, hovering like a helicopter. And then if I get close, I'm going, my Lord, who created you? God. And I said, I think about all of the intricacies and the details that he had to create to make that thing into that type of fly that could do what our helicopters that cost millions of dollars, and he does it with ease. But here we are, say we are. We're his highest creation. we're the ones that he wanted to fellowship with and have a relationship with forever. Forever. He wanted to hang out with Pastor Reeves forever and ever and ever and ever. And after that, we just started. He's a good God, ain't he? But guess what? I want to bring out this point, and I want you to catch this. You might have it made and not know that you have it made. Uh-oh. Let me try on this side. Can you say amen? You might have it made and not know that you got it made. Adam and Eve are in the garden. You don't have to punch no clock. Come on, are you hearing me, Pastor? Don't have to go by no Macy's or Tiffany or anything, all that stuff. Amen. They got it made. When they get hungry, don't even have to go by Publix. Just pluck something and eat. It comes with the fiber. They had it made and didn't even know they had it made. God had fixed that thing in such a way that all they had to do was just in the cool of the evening do what? He would do what? Come and do what? Hang out with Adam and Eve. But what do they do today? On this day, they hid themselves from what? They hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. Now, you can't hide from God because he's omnipresent. We know that. But the thing that we mess up on is this, is that God wants us to have a relationship with his manifested presence. There are times when you ought to have a prayer life or a worship life that when you enter into that worship experience, you can feel God's presence. It's called the manifested presence of God. Because God is omnipresent. He's everywhere. Amen. But there are times you need to feel it. Can I get a witness in this house? So here they're running from not God's omnipresent. They're running from his manifest. And God, check out God. God didn't come during the heat of the day. He came through the cool of the day to hang out with his greatest creation. He's a good God. Amen. And here they didn't know that Adam messed up. God says, he called on Adam, verse 9, and said unto him, where art thou? I tell you where he's at. He's out of place. He's out of place, Lord. He's supposed to be the guardian of his family. Lord, he is supposed to have his children in church today on Father's Day. But because he's out of place, Lord, they told him they weren't going nowhere. They told him that they're staying home. They're not getting out of bed. Totally out of place. What did the devil do? The devil, through the serpent, spoke to Eve and lied. And guess what happened? As a result of that lie, she got Adam to what back and eat of the forbidden fruit, and ate all they had that was going wonderful fell apart. So here's the point I want to make with you. Adam let things slide. What do you mean, Pastor? He let his wife talk to a snake or a serpent. Are you hearing, Pastor? He let it slide to the point where he lost everything. He should have been in between Eve and the what? Yo, man, what you doing talking to my wife? How come you gonna let the woman, let the man, let the serpent have a conversation with your wife, Adam? He didn't realize that what he let slide brought the whole thing what? Down. And that's where we are now. We have let so much stuff slide away until it's terrible. People now don't care about morals or values. They care about what they want. Amen. Amen. So Adam, he let it slide to the point where He messed everything up. Everything is messed up now. You had it made, my brother, and didn't even know you had it made. Now the whole thing changes. All the rules changes, and you've got the, all because you didn't stay in your place. Amen. Now understand something. I want you to realize, you know, they went through the whole process. Go down to verse 12, if you will. We'll back up to verse 11. Verse 11. And he said, who told thee that thou was naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat? And guess who he put it off on? What did he say in verse 12? And the man said, the woman what? She gave me of the tree and I what? And they are still playing the blame game right now. They're still playing the blame game on the woman. In other words, if I had a different woman, if I had a different wife, everything'd be all right. It's the woman that you gave me. She crazy. She be careful there. If you had given me another woman, if I had somebody else in my life, I could have made it. I could be successful by now. I could have been a millionaire by now if I had somebody else. Woman, spend everything that comes through here. The blame game. God didn't accept that. Nothing happened, nothing fell until Adam ate of that tree. Then everything fell apart. Can you say amen? So understand something, family. We're back to the situation now where it is the man's job to help his family enter back into what we call the manifested presence of God. The man is supposed to be the priest and king of that household. The man is supposed to stand up, if he has to do it every Sunday morning, as far as me and my house. Hey, we will serve whom? The Lord. That's your job. That's your job. You're the man of the house. You're the head of the house. God is holding the future. When I look at my grandkids, I love it. I love it. I love it. I have an opportunity to pour into their lives and pray that one day that they will grow up to be men that the girls have to fight over. Not because of their looks and like their granddaddy, but because of the character. Amen? Because of the personality, because of the type of people they are. Are you hearing what pastors say? I'm responsible. You're responsible. Get your eyes off of yourself. God gave you what he gave you. He gave you some influence and responsibility because he knew that you will pour into that child what they needed. Amen? It's the woman you gave me. Messed everything up. No, it's not. It's you, Adam. You're in charge of your home. You're in charge of your wife. You're supposed to help her also in her walk with the Lord. You're the king and priest of that home. Amen. So find your place and stay there. Can you say amen? Can I go on a little bit further? Go to Jonah chapter 1, verse 1. You see, the manifested presence of God is needed for us because that's where we were in the beginning. We need to have that. We need to put a value on God's presence. You know the story of Jonah? Jonah was the man who God gave instructions, told him to go and preach to Nineveh. But he didn't want to do what God asked him to do. He wanted to do something totally different. Now, verse 1. Now, the word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. All right, so God gave Jonah specific instructions of what to do. But look at verse 3. But Jonah rose up to flee unto what? Tarshish. From what? From the presence of the Lord. From the presence of the Lord. And where did he go? He went down to what? Joppa. And he found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare thereof and went down unto it. Gold, with them into onto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He's doing everything he can to stay out of the presence of the Lord. But look at verse 4. But the Lord sent out a what? Into the sea. And there was a mighty tempest in the sea so that the ship was likened to be broken. A lot of times, stuff you go through, it ain't always the devil. It ain't always the devil. Some of your circumstances, God can create those circumstances in order to try to get you to line up with what he wants you to do. Jonah said he's fleeing from the presence of God. Manifest presence of God running. God says, go here. Jonah says, I'm going there. And see, some of us, we don't realize we make our life hard because we choose to do it our way. Who is that man that sung that song, I have it what? My way. Amen. Jonah, you can't do that. And fathers, you can't just do what you want to do. You can't just have it what? Are you hearing me? But here he is. He's off course now. He's going to do it his way. So now as soon as he got on that boat, that thing started rocking and reeling. And they tried to do everything they could to fix it. Skip down with me to verse 12. Chapter 1. And he said unto them, take me up and cast me forth into the sea. So shall the sea be calm unto you. And for I know that for my sake this great tempest is upon you. Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to bring it to the land, but they could not, for the sea wrought and was tempestuous against them. So they took up Jonah and did what with him? Cast him what? Forth into the sea, and the sea did what? Cease. Go to verse 17. Now, God had something waiting for Jonah. The Bible in verse 17 says, now the Lord had prepared a what kind of fish? An Uber. Moby Dick Enterprise. It didn't say it was a whale. It was a great what? God could have sent a ship. He could have sent another ship. He could have been another passerby ship. Guess what? We're going to Nineveh. But God chose to send a... He chose to make a good impression on this particular individual. God could have had an ocean liner or something pass by and pick him up in that floating. But God made a great fish. Didn't say well, it made a fish. You remember the story where the little boy came home and was telling his parents and so forth about the teacher at school who talked to him about how Jonah was swallowed up by a whale, and the teacher said, you know, this is what happened. And the boy's parents says, you know, well, that's not, you don't believe that, because no whale can swallow a person. A little girl said, well, Mom, Dad, when I get to heaven, she said, I'm gonna ask Jonah all about it. She said, well, see, there you go. How you know Jonah went to heaven? He could have went to hell. And then the little girl said, you asked him. Then you asked him. But I believe it. I believe this man was swallowed by a fish created by God. See, God can tailor make a circumstance just for you. He can tailor make one. Tailor made. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Just for you. Jonah, go to Nineveh. I ain't going to no Nineveh. I ain't got nothing in Nineveh. Nineveh ain't got nothing in me. I ain't got nothing in Nineveh. Well, I ain't going to Nineveh. I'm going to Tarshish. That's what you think, buddy. You're going to Nineveh by way of Uberfish. And Jonah was inside the fish belly, my Lord. Now, if you believe this, there must have been an air pocket somewhere for him to breathe. My God, my God. Have you ever smelled or just do this. Have you ever sometimes, you know, you eat a good meal and sometimes you burp, gas comes up. Burns everything, doesn't it? Can you imagine his eyes when they hit the belly of that fish? Can you imagine what he felt, what he smelled? This brother is inside a great fish simply because he didn't stay in the place and do exactly what God wanted him to do. So here he is inside this fish. And the Bible says when he was in that fish, guess who had his undivided attention now? God. Go to Jonah chapter 2 real quickly. Then Jonah prayed unto the Lord his God out of the fish's belly and said, I cried by reason of mine affliction unto the Lord, and he heard me out of the belly of hell, cried I. Thou heardest my voice. Hallelujah. So he's describing this situation inside. Look at verse 5. The waters compassed me about, even to my soul. The death closed me round about. The weeds are wrapped around about my what? So the seaweeds are in there floating next to him. You know those things, you ever go to the beach, you see them seaweeds, they wash up on the beach and stuff. That brother is not having a good time. He said, I just wonder how much sleep did he get those 3 nights inside that fish. But look what happened though. Verse 9, but I will sacrifice unto thee with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay that I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. And the Lord spake unto the fish, and it did what? Lord Jesus. You ever been around someone? Lord, you can't help them. You just want to. Lord, my Lord. You don't want to get none of that on you. I know that they're the kinfolk, they're relatives, but you don't want none of that on you. And you know what, too? It has a certain smell to it, too. Y'all ain't going to make me, I got you now. Look at some of you finding up right now, because you know what I'm talking about, don't you? You know exactly what I'm talking about. This did not have to happen, Jonah. All you had to do is find your place and stay in your place with God. It didn't have to happen. So now here he is. My God. That acid was burning his eyes, burning his nose, burning every part of the. That acid was slowly trying to digest his skin and so forth, because his skin is peeling. And look here. Look here. He's now. He can see the sun. He can see the clouds. Oh, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. That little fish probably is wiggling himself back into the water. And Jonah is on, the Bible says he's on what now? He's on dry what? He's on dry land. My Lord, my Lord, my Lord. Now here's the kicker, and Pastor's going to move on. Verse chapter 3 real quickly. And the word of the Lord came unto Jonah the what? Are you here? What is it? Came the second what? All right. So if you don't get it the first time, don't think that God is going to let you off the hook. Are you hearing, Pastor? God comes back to Jonah with the same assignment, with the same word. You see, something you have to realize about God, even if you're trying to grow to another level or get to another level, God does not believe in social promotion. Amen. You know, a lot of us got messed up because the teacher just passed us on. How do you get to high school in 11th grade and can't read? Amen, somebody? So God is not like that. He doesn't give you a social promotion. He came right back to Jonah and said, guess what, my brother, the second time, I want you to go where? To Nineveh. And I want you to catch it out there. Well, this time there's a whole different response. Whole different response. Whole different response. Now, Jonah, look at verse 3. Arose and went unto Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now, Nineveh was an exceeding great city of how many days' journey? 3 days' journey. I want you to catch this. Look at verse 4. And Jonah began to enter into the city a what? He cut off 2 days. What was his motivation? Are you hearing, Pastor? What motivated him? The brother, it's going to take 3 hours for us to probably get from here to Jacksonville. Just want you to know, that's just kind of standing. That's, you know, going to speed limit, man. You know, whatever. But it's going to be about a three-hour ride, man. Not for Jonah. 1 hour. He cut the other two off. What motivated him? That fish. What is it that God has to do in our lives to get us to be motivated enough to do what he says he told us to do? Amen. Amen. Bible says second time, he's running now, baby. He's on fire for the Lord. And that's what you have to realize. Some of us, we make life hard because we're not being obedient to God, what he's spoken to us and told us to do. We make things hard. Amen. Y'all still with Pastor right there? Go and be where God has placed you. Stay where God has placed you. And he has a purpose for everything he's doing. Now, I wanted to talk to us two just for a moment. When we look at life, realize that life is a little difficult. Some of us are having to struggle. Some of us are having to just do things we haven't done. We just has been, you know, kind of like tricked by the devil. Because he always uses a famous quote and statement, those two words called by now. For some of you, he says, by now you should have been further along than where you are. By now you should have been out of debt. By now you should have a house, you should have a home. By now you should, you know, by now, come on, by now. By now you ought to be married. Girl, you knocking on 40. You ought to be. See, the enemy uses that by now quote against us so he can get us out of place with God. You have to realize with God, timing is everything. Amen. Look at Psalms 84 real quickly. And verse 11, for the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk how? No good thing will he withhold from them that walk up what? Now, I take that word, and I stay with that. I stay on that word. I realize that if I don't have it, it's not good. And sometimes you don't have it because it's the timing. There's nothing wrong with a mother having a baby. Nothing wrong with a mother having a baby. But if the mother is 13, if the mother who's about to have the baby is 13 years old, then there's something wrong with the timing. Can you say amen? Oh, it's such a blessing when you celebrate the arrival of a little child, when everything is in its proper order. Are you hearing, Pastor? So keep that in mind. Understand that no good thing will he withhold. I find that place in the Bible, and I kind of park there for a while. I rest there. No good thing will he withhold from me if I just walk uprightly. Look at Proverbs 10:22. How many want to be blessed by the Lord? I do too. I want to find that place of where God will just bless and bless and bless. Look what it says in Proverbs 10:22. The blessing of the Lord, let's read it together. The blessing of the Lord, it maketh what? And addeth no. Blessing of the Lord addeth no sorrow with it. But it maketh you what? Oh, my Lord, it maketh you rich, but it adds no sorrow. I try to park there. I find that place in God's word. But you say, Lord, if I find your blessing, it's going to make me wealthy or whatever, and rich. It's not just things and money, but it's also in other ways we can be wealthy and healthy. Can you say amen? Well, look at Proverbs 22:7. The rich ruleth over the poor, and the borrower is servant to the what? Lender. Wow. The rich ruleth over the poor, and the borrower is servant to the lender. Our Lord, help me to try to live off this verse too. Let me do all I can to stay out of debt, Lord, because you're saying that the borrower is slave to the lender. Amen? And you know where we are? Here we are. Just say, what if you're 50 right now and they're signing you up for a 30-year mortgage? And it's pricey out there a little bit. Let's just say your payment is $3,000 a month. In 30 years, you'd be 80. Amen. And in 30 years, you would have paid more than it's going to be over $1 million. $3,000 a month. You know what? I want to park there for a little bit and stay away from that. Can you say amen? And look at, here's the scary part. Everything that our government is doing, everything that our government is talking about, guess what? Where the money is coming from? It's borrowed what? It's borrowed money, family. It's borrowed money. It is borrowed money. And anytime you borrow money, I hope we can teach the kids this. You rob from your future in order to try to accommodate your present. You rob from your future to accommodate your present. Guess what? So when people do get old and they can't work and they can't get around, if they have not sown toward their future, they're not going to have the resources there when they get there. Amen? And I don't want to be 80-year-old bagging Publix groceries. I love you, but I don't want to bag no groceries at 80 years old. Can you say amen, somebody? Hallelujah. So I want to find that spot where in my heart and the Lord helping me that I can stay there and rest in that place. Matthew 6:31. I know you think, Pastor? I'm just going to finish this verse and these three verses. And if you let me, I'm going to give you my closing. And we're going to move on. Can you say amen? Shout hallelujah. Amen. Matthew 6:31. On this Father's Day, a lot of fathers are frustrated because things are high, things are difficult. Things are simply expensive. Well, there's a place where you can park that will take care of all that, even in God's word. Verse 31, Matthew 6:31 says, therefore take no thought saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or wherewith shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles what? Seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. For your heavenly Father knoweth that you have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of what? And his righteousness, and all these things shall be what? She'll be at. Now you know, Pastor, you hear Pastor quote this a lot. I try to rest on that verse because I've lived long enough to see the goodness of God. Now you hear about those testimonies over and over and over, but I wouldn't be standing here behind this platform or this podium if it had not been for the goodness of God adding to our lives. He's a good God, amen? So to the fathers out there, you're frustrated. And if God has a home for you, granite countertops, or however you want to, you don't have to worry about that. You don't have to even sweat that. All you got to do is prioritize God. Amen. And if that's what he has for you, it will simply be added. My God, it will simply be added. You don't have to sweat it. You know this can't continue. You know how many people, by those who are scuffling to get into a home, this can't continue. You can't continue. $3,000 a month. Well, I'm through with y'all. I'm going to go down to the apartment complex. $2,000 a month. This can't continue. So you know where this is headed. This is headed to a collision course with just common sense. Amen. So how do you do it, Pastor? You park, you find your place, and you stay there. Help me finish this thing. Say, find your place. Fathers, find your place and stay there, man. Park there. Rest there. Check your mind. Check your mind. What are you thinking? Don't let negativity come in. Don't let nothing that's going to pull you away from what you believe in God for stop you from believing and trusting God. Find that place, fathers. Find it in God's word, family. You're supposed to be the Bible study teacher, not pastor. But you're supposed to be the Bible study teacher in your home and in your family. Find what you're looking for, children. Find a word of God that applies just to you. Park there. Park there, right there, right there. Park right there on that scripture that you're holding home to and you're believing God for. Stay right there. And don't go anywhere. Can you say amen? Find your place. You see, we pass to look around the church and so forth. And I know there's members who just, you know, who are just not here, whatever, for whatever reason might be. But I don't get discouraged or worried about anything. You know why? Because I found my place in the Word. Come on now. It says, he who has begun. I didn't start it. Y'all ain't with Pastor. Can you say amen? I didn't start it. He told me to do what? Are y'all here, Pastor? You know, so I come in here, there's a few, there's more than a few, whatever. God bless you. And God keep you, amen? Because I can park on that scripture. He will finish it. He's a good God. Can you hear, Pastor? So find your place and stay there. And we got some things for the gift. We're going to close out with this little illustration. If you pray for Pastor, I'm going to close out with you. You guys are just, you're wonderful and you're special. But I just want you to start, you know, getting deeper rooted and staying where you're supposed to be. I can remember when we was in the cafeteria for a church, I prayed to the Lord. I said, Lord, don't let me take the members and bounce them from place to place. I don't want to do that, Lord. I said, Lord, when we come out of this cafeteria, I want to be able to go into our sanctuary. This is what I'm placing my trust and heart in. Forward, Lord. I don't want to come out of here and go somewhere else to rent. I don't want to do that. I don't want to rent here, rent there, rent there, rent there. I know we can do that, but I personally don't want to do that. I want, when we leave the cafeteria, we will go and have a place where we can worship and where the chairs don't move and the carpet doesn't roll. And guess what God did? He put us in the place. The chairs still move a little bit if you rearrange them. But we don't have to stack them. We don't have to get all... He's a good God. Amen. What you have to do is find your place in that word. What is it that you believe in God for? What are you trusting God for? Find your place. Get there and what? And just stay there. They laugh at you or whatever. Get there and stay there. And watch God work on your behalf. Like the little man, as I close, this is my last closing. Yeah, for today, thanks. He had a store that his family had for years. Little small store. Wasn't too big, just a little small store. And the big boys had bought up property all around him and made him an offer to sell. And he said, I'm not selling. This is my family property. It's been in the family for years. I'm keeping it in the family. I'm staying right here. They said, we're going to give you one last chance to take our offer, because if you won't sell to us, they said, we're going to just simply build around you and shut you down. And true to their word, they built all around them, big plaza type mall, big old buildings and so forth. And right in the middle there, it was this little store surrounded by all these other big new stores. And the business owner came by and says, I told you what I was going to do. He said, yes, sir, you did, but I'm still praying to God. God hasn't told me to do anything, move, whatever. I'm going to stay right here. So he said, we're opening in 2 weeks. So sure enough, they open up. And they had these two big signs saying, grand opening. And they were flashing. And when he came down, he looked at it and saw that, Lord, you see what they're doing? He said, oh, don't worry about it. You find your place and you stay in your what? Place. So the big old sign said, they'll be on next week, grand opening. They will be opening next week. So the Lord says, you too find two words. And put these two words above your store. And what two words are those, Lord? When they put grand opening, you put main entrance. Stand to your feet, family. Someone help Pastor say, God will make a way. If you stand there, if you stand... Find in the word what God has spoken to you and he's speaking to you. Stand there. When it looks hopeless, trust God. I love you guys. Many of you, you come to church and you're tired. And I know you are. I know you are. And I appreciate you so much. You know how special you are to Pastor. Amen. I'm not going to, I know you're tired, so forth. But you make your way, you press your way, you come anyway. And Pastor, for that, wants to say thank you so much. Amen. We appreciate you. God bless you. On this Father's Day, that's the word he gave me, basically. He said, don't find your place. Find your place. And especially in the Bible, find your place in the word. Stay there. Amen. My wife, she has that old bulldog kind of faith. And bulldog, they said a bulldog knows is tilt back because he can bite you and keep on breathing. That's why it's tilt backward, it says. So God is a good God. I think they have something special for the fathers, just like the mothers, so we're not going to tarry. If those of you who are watching us by way of YouTube, we want you to realize that, as you heard pastors say time and time again, everyone under the sound of my voice who's here in service, they are special, wonderful, God-sent people I'm so proud of just to be called their pastor. I'm so grateful. And they make that special effort, and many have come from afar just to show their presence and their appreciation. And I'm grateful for them too. But now those of you watching by line, God bless you. And we're grateful for you also. But we would love to see you. Love for you to be a part of our worship experience. So you are invited. And those of you who don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior, pray this prayer with me. Say, Our Father, on this day we can say Our Father. Yes, because you're not just Father to some, you're Father to everyone. Ask Him to forgive you of your sins. Ask Him to cleanse you of all iniquity and all transgressions. Ask Him to come into your heart, Lord Jesus, and to be your Lord and Savior. And He'll do that right now. He'll do that. Let Him know that you believe that He died, crucified, and died, and He rose again just for you. And you will be a new creature in Christ Jesus. So we thank you, Father. We give you all glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' precious name, we say thank you. And we say to God be the glory. Amen. If you give us a few minutes, family, we want to celebrate the fathers that's here right now.